يوعدون لآجل وما أنتم بمعجزين. Praise Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He's the only one worthy of praise. Seek His help, His guidance, and His forgiveness. I believe in Him and I trust Him. I seek refuge in Almighty Allah from the evil of our passions. Indeed, whosoever Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala guides him to Islam, no one can mislead him after Allah. And whosoever Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala puts him astray, no one can guide him after Allah. I testify openly that there is no deity worthy of worship except Allah Rabbil Alameen. And I testify that Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is his messenger, the seed of all the prophets. O Muslims, you must know that the best speech is the speech of Almighty Allah, which is the Quran. The best guidance is the course of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The words of all affairs is innovation and addition to the religion of Islam. Indeed, every addition to the religion of Islam will lead to hellfire. I adjure you as well as myself to fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to the best of your ability. Fear Allah and don't die unless you are Muslims. This lecture concerning the plots of the enemies. In actuality, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, for his reason and his wisdom, had made the human being in general and the believers be surrounded by different types of enemies. And this is one of the ways to test our faith and our belief and our sincerity and how much we are committed to this program of Islam. The enemies are a lot. They are everywhere. And we don't have to go too far, because your nafs, your own soul, is one of your enemies. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, وَنَفْسٍ وَمَا سَوَّاهَا فَأَلْهَمَهَا فُجُورَهَا وَتَقْوَاهَا قَدْ أَفْلَحَ مَنْ زَكَّاهَا وَقَدْ خَابَ مَنْ دَسَّاهَا. So the nafs, your own soul, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given it the two directions, the two ways. And if this nafs is not going to be nafs mutma'inna, neither is going to be nafs lawwama, and it's going to be an evil soul, and it chooses one of these two ways, which is not the way that Allah wants for it. Allah said, وَقَدْ خَابَ مَنْ دَسَّاهَا. A loser, a person who had allowed himself and his soul to drag him to hellfire. So sometimes when we talk about enemies, we talk about the outside enemies. But I want, in the beginning of my speech, to draw our attention to that your own enemy can be your own self, can be even your own family. من أولادكم وأولادكم فتنة. That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had told us, among our own children, our own families, can be enemies for you. And also we understand the shaitan is one of the enemies. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told us, إن الشيطان لكم عدو فاتخذوه عدوا. Indeed, the shaitan, Satan, is an open enemy for you. So take him as the enemy. And also the dunya, and the attraction of this dunya, can be one of the world's enemies of us. Which Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has told us, مَا تَرَبْتُ فِتْنَةً بَعْدِي لكل أمة فتنة وفتنة أمة المال. So the Prophet of Allah صلى الله عليه وسلم had told us that every ummah has an enemy, has trial and test. The test of this ummah is the man running behind the dunya. They try to get the money, get the dollar. Sometimes it's expenses of our own deen and our own belief. So this dunya itself can be an enemy for you. Because you لَكُمْ لَكُمْ أَمْوَالُهُمْ وَأَوْلَادُهُمْ عَنْ ذِكْرِ اللَّهِ وَمَنْ يَفْعَلْ ذَلِكَ فَأُولَئِكَ هُمُ الْخَاسِرُونَ. Don't let your family and your property beguile you and take you away from the remembrance of Allah, and whosoever does so will be among the losers. So you can see how serious it is being living in this life that is surrounded with all this. The shaitan, your soul, your family, and sometimes you want to please your family, especially your wife that always putting demands in you. She wants a TV. No, she don't like this black and white TV, she wants a color one. 2-3 years later she wants, she's not satisfied with the color TV, she wants one with a remote control. So now you have to go and work more. And the more you work, the more you're staying away from the masjid. Yes, I'm coming to it. Okay? The more that you stay away from the masjid. Because now she don't want a color TV, she want one with a remote control. Because it's too much to get up from the chair and go to the TV, change the channel. So we want to be relaxed, understand, and keep clicking the channel while you're resting. But 2-3 years later, now she's not happy with this remote control TV and the color TV. She want a bigger one, okay? I think it's what, 30 inches or something like this. But a year later now, this doesn't work. She need a satellite. She need a dish. You see? So, and the more she put demands in you, I want to make her happy. You don't want to be getting, say, brother, it's too much headache for me. Let me save myself from this headache and get her what she wants. You see? Get her what she wants. If it's pleasing to Allah and something helpful for her. So now you can see how your wife can be an enemy dragging you to hellfire, and you keep answering his call, and every time you're doing it, it's not a matter of working more hours, getting more money, or maybe even you go indulge in interest on haram because you don't have money to buy this dish. So now you have to go to the bank and borrow money and deal with using an interest. Now you're getting more in the haram. But it's not going to be this only, it's going to be the destruction having to your family with bringing this dish or this deal to your house, and the children will be watching, and these things will be printed in their mind. So you can see how it's even your own family, your own wife. I didn't even start the health care question right away. Thank you very much. I didn't start the lecture yet. I'm only trying to get in a mood of a lecture because I'm a little bit disturbed. We enjoy the talk of women. Could you please give 10 minutes on how the men should treat their wives? So this is a comment from the sisters, it's not a question. Sisters say, Brother Muhammad Adli, Jazakallah khairan, we enjoy the talk of women that I just gave it in the gym before Maghrib. Could you please give 10 minutes on how men should treat their wives. So she telling me to get out of this channel of women, not to keep talking too much about the wives. Hate the brothers a little bit. But do you know what more brothers? So with all these enemies, we're surrounded with all this shaitan, the nafs, your family, your own soul can be your enemy, temptation of this dunya material thing. And with all this, still other enemies, the kuffar. Not only the kuffar, the deviant sects also, okay, from all kinds of groups and sects of the Islam. So you are not Muslim, neither you about astaghfirullah kufr, you in something that space out someplace, okay. So now we are surrounded with all these enemies. But believe it or not, my brothers, this is not something you need for us being living in the United States or Canada. But even the prophets, listen, even the prophets themselves, they had enemies. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, with his own wisdom, for whatever reason, he made this always going to be a challenge between the haqq and the batil, between the falsehood and the truth, between the bid'ah and the sunnah, between the deviation and the true Islam. It's going to be always a battle running, okay? And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he wants to see the sincere and the serious one among ourselves. If it's going to be so easy and simple to be a Muslim, and you want to go to the masjid, nobody disturbing you, and everything will be fine, everybody will go to paradise with no problem. It's no challenge, you see? It has to be a challenge. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made it to be there. In Surah Al-Furqan, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala saying in verse number 31, Surah number 25, وَكَذَلِكَ جَعَلْنَا لِكُلِّ نَبِيٍ عَدُوًا مِنَ الْمُشْرِمِينَ لِكُلِّ نَبِيٍ. Indeed, we made for every prophet enemies among the criminals ones. Okay? And you can read through the whole Quran. What happened with the Prophet Lut? What happened with the Prophet Noah? What happened with the Prophet Yusuf? What happened with the Prophet Yunus? Always they have some people objecting their da'wah. You have some people calling them liars. They have some people they calling them names. Okay? They have enemies. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala telling us in Surah An-Nisa, for me and you and everybody, إِنَّ الْكَافِرِينَ كَانُوا لَكُمْ عَدُوًّا مُبِينًا. Surah An-Nisa, verse 101. إِنَّ الْكَافِرِينَ. Kuffar, what do you mean by, what do you mean by kuffar? You try to tell us the Christian or the Jewish? Yeah, maybe we know about the Jews, they talk Palestine. But the Christian here is very good. There is nothing called a Christian or a Jew very good. The person who has no good in Allah, there is no good in him. The person who doesn't know Tawheed, La ilaha illallah, is not good. Even if he built hospitals. Like some people talking about Mama Tracy. Or Mama Tracy, or what about her name? Mama Tracy. Teresa. Oh, so now I want somebody to wake up. Teresa. And Mama Teresa? No, it's not Mama Teresa, it's Mama. No, it's not Mother Teresa also. She is not our mother. Our mother is Khadija and Aisha. It is their mother. It is their mother. Okay? Not even. This is their mother. But our mother is Khadija and Aisha and Umm Salama. These are our mothers. Who are? Good deeds that you do it have to start with Allah, your creator, first by acknowledging him to be your creator, the source of all the blessings, and the only one worthy of your worship and your praise. If you don't know Allah, you know nothing, and if you have no good in Allah, you have no good for the human being. So don't be deceived that somebody making some good here, building a hospital for the dogs, and building an orphan house, and now you see all these people, good people, you try to tell me, this kuffar is a kuffar. They good, they do a lot of good things, more than the Muslims. No, you have to know what is good. Good, what Allah called good. And the end, the good doesn't start with iman, you don't know what is good. So Allah said, in al-kafirin, all the kuffar, all those who don't believe in la ilaha illallah, Muhammadur Rasulullah, they are kuffar, they are going to Jahannam if they die in this kufr, and they are what? They are an open enemy for you. So when Allah telling you they are kuffar, and Allah telling you they are enemies, you better treat them as enemies, or otherwise you don't trust Allah. Never trust them. They are not doing anything for your own good. And if they did anything that you may see it to be good, it is the way how we catch the mice with the cheese, or peanut butter. It depends which one is cheaper in your city, okay? Don't tell me that you love the mice. You put the cheese or peanut butter inside the trap pig. For what? You want to feed the mice? No. You hate these mice and you want to kill these mice. So don't ever expect your enemies that they're going to bought you a honey or peanut butter or a cheese because they love you. Brother, you don't see all this, you understand? Trucks and ships who take all the food, you understand, to Bosnia and take it. Yeah. After they destroy, after they kill, after they make them bleed, after they make them cry. Now, after they kill the husbands, the fathers, all these things, they go and bend the shoulder and give them some food. What kind of food? No, let me starve him and don't kill my father, don't kill my sister, don't kill anybody. You see? And don't take our children for the missionaries to tell them to be kuffar. And after this, you bring trucks loaded with rice and beans. No. إِنَّ الْكَافِرِينَ كَانُوا لَكُمْ عَدُوًا مُبِينًا. Why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, وَأَعِدُّ لَهُمْ مَا اسْتَطَعْتُمْ مِنْ قُوَّةٍ وَمِنْ رِبَاطِ الْخَيْلِ تُرْهِبُونَ بِهِ عَدُوًّا. Oh, that Allah even have enemies. There's some people, they hate Allah. They hate the book of Allah. They hate the deen of Allah. تُرْهِبُونَ بِهِ عَدُوَّ اللَّهِ وَعَدُوَّكُمْ. So whosoever the enemies of Allah is our enemy, even if he's smiling our face. There is nothing worse than to describe his son to Allah. لَقَدْ شِئْتُمْ شَيْئًا إِدَّا تَكَادُ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَتَفَطَّرْنَ مِنْ وَتَخِرُّ الْجِبَالِ. What is that, the verse? لَقَدْ شِئْتُمْ شَيْئًا إِدَّا تَكَادُ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَتَفَطَّرْنَ مِنْهُ وَتَنْشَقُّ الْأَرْضُ وَتَخِرُّ الْجِبَالُ أَدَّا أَنْ دَعَوْا لِلرَّحْمَنِ وَلَدًا وَمَا يَنْبَغِي لِلرَّحْمَنِ أن يتخذ ولدا إن كل من في السماوات والأرض إلا آت الرحمن عبدا. This is the worst crime. A crime was cause an earthquake. It can make the earth split and make the mountains fall. تُرْهِبُونَ بِعَدُوِّ اللَّهِ. Those are the enemies of Allah. And the enemies of Allah have to be your enemy. Because your love to Allah have to come to before any other love. So those who are the enemies of Allah, it have to be your enemy and never trust them. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala telling us this in surah number 60, Al-Mumtahan, verse number 1, very clear. Ya ayyuhal ladhina aman, oh you believe. If we are believers, we better listen. What Allah is telling us, Ya ayyuhal ladhina amanu, la tattakhidhu adiwi wa aduwakum awliya. لا تتخذوا عدوي my enemy and your enemy as a أولياء, as a protector, as a friend. Don't have loyalty to them because they don't think about you, they don't care for you. They may smile, but this smile has something else behind it, exactly like somebody who can cheese for the mice. لا تتخذوا عدوي my enemies and your enemy as awliya, as a friend, as protectors, as helpers, to be the supporters for you against the Muslims. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in Surah Al-Imran, verse number 3, verse number 21, excuse me, Surah number 3, إن الذين يكفرون بآيات الله ويقتلون النبيين بغير حق ويقتلون الذين يأمرون بالقسط من الناس فبشرهم بعذاب أليم. See their crimes, it been extended towards the prophets, killing the prophets. They don't want the word of Tawheed to be established. They don't want to be Allah to be the only Lord to be worshipped. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, those who deny and reject the signs of Allah, the verses of Allah, the revelation of Allah, and they kill the prophets with no just reason. And not only this, because the battle is going to continue until the day of judgment, وَيَقْتُلُونَ الَّذِينَ يَقْرُونَ الْقِسْطِ مِنَ النَّاسِ. They're going to kill the scholars and the leaders of Muslims community and those who try to establish justice and fairness among the human beings. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, فَبَشِّرْهُمْ بِعَذَابٍ أَلِيمٍ. Let them have the glad tidings for the world's punishment. My brothers and my sisters, the enemy is here. And they plotted against us night before the day. They don't sleep because Islam is forever and nothing scares them more than Islam. But when the Muslims became adopted this Islam as a way of life, otherwise they got to be like the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, تتداعى عليكم الأمم كما تتداعى الأكلة على قصعها. قالوا أمن قلة نحن يا رسول الله؟ قال لا، ولكنكم غثاء كغثاء السيل. The Prophet of Allah صلى الله عليه وسلم said, nations will come crowding over you, attacking you from everywhere. Like what? Like a starving people been served with a meal. Can you imagine, like 2 o'clock after everybody been working from after Salat al-Fajr. And now say lunchtime and you get this Bukhari rice or basmati rice, a big drink. And everybody will sweat, hungry, been working for 7 hours. Look how everybody will jump on it. The Prophet ﷺ said it's going to happen that the nation, Paris, England, America, Russia, Canada, name it. All this kuffar, all this nation will come jumping, trying to kill you. Same way like a starving people been served with the meal. The Sahaba, they've been shocked to hear this. They said, أَذِنْ قِلَّةِ نَحْنِ يَا رَسُولَ اللَّهِ How? Because we are few. Our number is little, limited. We are a small city, small country, small community. Said, لا. Said, no. It's not because this reason, but you are غُثَاءُ غُثَاءُ السَّيْدِ. You have, you plenty number, billions. But what? No reality for you, no value for you, no any respect for you. You'll be like the fog that flood over the water. When you look at the ocean and all the things you see like flooding on top of the water, pieces of sticks and papers and trash and garbage. So the water be pushing it to the side. Has no way. Has no way. Therefore, it will be like this, okay? So the battle is not ever going to be ended. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made this clear, and for all the Muslims to have to understand, the battle, it didn't end it, and it's going to be always here. Listen to Surah Al-Baqarah, Surah number 2, verse 217. وَلَا يَزَالُونَ يُقَاتِلُونَكُمْ حَتَّى يَرُدُّوكُمْ عَنْ دِينِكُمْ إِنْ اسْتَطَعُوا. To continue fighting you. When's it going to stop? If they can turn you away from your deen. Now when they achieve this is going to be the end of the battle, okay? As long as you want to continue holding to the Book of Allah and the authentic Sunnah of Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, live in Islam. Not only what you think is Islam, not the American Islam, not the 20th century Islam. If you want to live Islam, they will continue fighting you to turn you away from your deen if they have means to do so. They will find all kinds of means. They will continue fighting you. My brothers, my sisters, the battle never ended, never going to end. It's not going to end. And we have to understand that every day from the moment we get up until the moment you go to sleep, you are a soldier. And you are in a battle. And you have to do your best not to be defeated or be conquered. You're going to be faced by kuffar. You're going to be faced by temptation. You're going to be faced by power. You're going to be faced by the shaitan. You're going to be faced by your family. You're going to be faced by so-called Muslims. You're going to have a lot of enemies, and it's going to be a big battle. And you have to understand, like the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, كل الناس يغدو فبائع النفس فمعتقها أو موبقها. Each one of us like a businessman. You go to the market carrying your own soul. One of us will lose his soul, or that you're going to be a winner. You come back with your soul. When you step outside the door, the battle starts. وَلَا يَزَالُونَ يُقَاتِلُونَ حتى يردوكم عن دينكم. But wait, what is the challenge of it? Say, brother, what, from where are you coming? I'm a Muslim, everybody in my job knows that I'm a Muslim. I never, nobody ever tell me anything. I never see anybody understand, hate me or anybody. Yeah. What are you doing? I'm working in an insurance company. Oh, yeah. Who's this lady standing? Oh, is this my wife? Oh, now I know why they are not. You don't have any problem. When you start living as a Muslim, earn halal dar, make your wife cover like a Muslim, you grow your beard, you take the sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, you look like a Muslim, you behave like a Muslim, live like a Muslim, now you don't want to make you understand, be American Muslim, okay? Now you will know how serious it is. يبتلى الرجل على قدر دينه. يبتلى الرجل على قدر دينه. That every one of you will be tested according to his deen. If your deen is strong, the test will be strong. If your deen is so-and-so, now your test will be so-and-so. Okay? This is all that I can tell you. Listen, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when the Sahaba asked him, أمن قلة نحن يا رسول الله؟ قال لا ولكنكم كثير ولكنكم غثاء كغثاء السيل. After this the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم said ولينزعن الله مهابتكم من صدور أعدائكم وليقذفن في قلوبكم الوهن. قالوا وما الوهن يا رسول الله؟ قال حب الدنيا وكراهة الموت. Say, O Prophet of Allah, this nation will jump on us like this, attacking us, snatching us piece by piece. It's because we are few in number. Say no, you are plenty in that time. But you have no value. Okay? No, you have no real existence. And indeed Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will remove your fear from the hearts of your enemy. The dignity and the respect and the honor of you, that your enemies care for you, Allah will take it away from their hearts. They will walk over you like they walk in the dirt. And Allah will throw in your heart wahan. The illness, the sickness, the disease called wahan. Say, O Prophet of Allah, what is wahan? He said, love of this dunya, the love of this material thing, and the hate of death. You don't want to die. You don't want jihad. You don't want to hear about jihad. You don't want to understand to die. You love this dunya and every day you see more and more fascinated. You get so fascinated with seeing this life. Every day something, they discover something more. And they make it more fancy. And they make it more bush buttons. And make it more easy to you. Now the more that you love this. You love this dunya. And now you want to live forever so you can enjoy this. You don't want to meet Allah. You don't want to go for jihad. So you are not going to have any value. So as long as you're going to be American Muslim and a Muslim of the 20th century, and you're going to be like when you are in Rome, acting like Roman people, when you are in Paris, you act like the people in Paris, you are not going to be acceptable by Allah and His Messenger. No, you be Muslim wherever you want to be. Even if you take you on the moon, you have to live as a Muslim and act like a Muslim and appear as a Muslim. But when you go to America, be American Muslim, and you go to Arabia, be Arab Muslim, we don't want this kind of Islam. It's not going to help you. But this is from the paths of the enemy. Indeed, the enemies had worked a lot against Islam, against the deen of Allah. And as we stated in Surah Al-Furqan, وَكَذَلِكَ جَعَلْنَا لِكُلِّ نَبِيٍ عَدُوًّا مِنَ الْمُجْرِمِينَ. Indeed, we had appointed for every prophet a messenger, an enemy from the criminals ones. Okay? So this is going to be happening in every time, in everywhere. But I want to give a brief talk concerning things to remind us about what had happened in the past, especially with our Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. From the day one, they start putting doubt about the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. They start to put doubt about this Quran. And we understand that the Quran came to defend this notion or this argument or this doubt that they're raising. Okay? That this Quran been from other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala stated, وَإِنْ كُنْتُمْ فِي رَبِّ مِمَّا نَزَّلْنَا عَلَىٰ عَبْدِنَا فَأْتُوا بِسُورَةٍ مِّنْ مِثْلِهِ وَدُعُوا شُهَدَاءَكُمْ مِنْ دُونِ اللَّهِ إِنْ كُنْتُمْ صَادِقِينَ. If you are in doubt that this Quran is not from Allah, so what about you bring and produce one surah? And not only that, and bring witnesses. Bring witnesses and let them see that what you brought is something similar to what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did. They made doubt. He said this asatir al-awwalin. Ibtatabaha. فَهِيَ تُمْنَ عَلَيْهِ بُكْرَةً وَعَصِيرًا. Is this nothing but previous stories and things that been taught to the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam? Okay. Oh, the Prophet Muhammad used to go and sit to this man there. Oh, he went to understand his journeys and he learned from this rahib and this magician and all the things. Oh, he is not a prophet. He is a poor man. وَقَالُوا مَا لِهَذَا الرَّسُولِ يَأْكُلُ الطَّعَامَ وَيَمْشِي الْأَسْوَاقِ. How he can be a prophet? And he's walking in the street, in the marketplace, like any one of us. He eats food like us. How he can be a messenger? So they use this, putting doubts in the people's mind concerning the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and also concerning the source of information of this deen, which is Al-Quran Al-Kareem. They did not succeed. They use different methods, and I'm sure all of you are aware about what's happened to the family of Yasir, and what's happened to Sumayya, what's happened to Bilal, radiallahu anhum jami'an, and everything that happened, not even to the Sahaba, even to the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So now they start to use different methods, a physical means, physical punishment, to put it to the Sahaba. And also put it in the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. You know, these things didn't work. They used, because the enemies, you can call them Christian, you can call them Jewish, you can call them kuffar. They are enemies of this deen, the enemies of the da'wah. They are in the past, they are in the present, they are in the future. The main problem is the deen, because the deen is telling them la ilaha illallah. That you worship none but Allah, and that there is no ruler except Allah. In al-hukm wa illa billah. You could not be the governor. You could not be the man in charge. You can be in charge only to carry the order of Allah, to impose the sharia of Allah. But you could not be the one who make law for the people. In al-hukm wa illa billah, ruling and legislation is only belong to Allah. So everybody see that Islam is a threat to their seat, to their position as a king or as a ruler or as a president or as a congress or whatever it is. Because Islam telling us that you could not rule by any ruling except by deen of Islam. Okay? In al-hukm illa lillah. So they see the threat in Islam. They try to boycott the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam and the people. They put in them in Sha'b ibn Abi Talib for 3 years. No one deals with Muhammad and the Muslims. No one buys from them. No one sells to them. Like they do in some countries nowadays. You are not going to listen. We're going to go to what? What they call this thing in there? Sanction. Okay? All right, they put it like they put it in Iraq, they put it in Somalia, they put it everywhere. So basically, the same means, okay? They did this with the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam 1400 years ago. Okay, what comes in? No marriage. We don't marry your people, we don't marry our people. No business, okay? Something similar, the same way. Okay, you're going to listen or no more rice. You're going to listen or no more umla sa'ba. No more doubt. Are you going to listen and work with us? Or next time understand when somebody else about to make revolution? Okay, America going to support them, or Russia going to support them. So now they will take over and they take the government, and now you're going to be in jail. So you better understand bow down for us today. So if you get to know us today, we will know you tomorrow. When you need our help, we'll be there. You don't? Okay, we need it. What am I going to do? Now, when they eat you out and throw you in jail, this is your problem. Okay? So the same thing they did with the Prophet Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم. Temptation. Temptation. How? What's the problem, Muhammad? You want to be rich? We collect money and give you. What's the problem? You want to be the chief? We make you the chief. What do you want? Women? We choose the best and the most beautiful women among us, and we give you. So they always looking from going from torturing the people and punishing them physically, to boycotting them, to sanction on them, and after this temptation, we give you this. Okay, send him airline ticket, bring him here to America, let him see all this good stuff, and say, okay, we take care of you, we make you study here in our schools, until you understand you grow and you be a big man, when you go there, keep in touch, we take care of you, and after this, later on, we send you somebody to help you, to take over, and you be the king, you be the president. What do you want, Muhammad? Stop this thing about La ilaha illallah. Why are you saying this stuff? What do you need? We give it to you. No, it's not about this. So this is one of the plots of the enemies of Allah. It's not going to work? All right. Since there's nothing is working, let's kill him. You know? So they always have different methods and different means. If this doesn't work, go to the next one, go to the next one. And after this, ثانية اثنين. إذ أخرجه الذين كفروا. ثانية اثنين إذ هما في الغار. إذ يقول لصاحبه لا تحزن إن الله معك. ها؟ وإذ يمكر بك الذين كفروا ليخرجوك أو ها؟ أو يقتلوك. That was the verse. أو يفوتوك، أوكي؟ So the same message that happened with the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم. They plotted against Muhammad. They got to find a way. So because now he's still telling them لا إله إلا الله محمد رسول الله. So you have to find a way to deal with you. So now they got to plot against you. They got to try to kill you. They got to do something. So now the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم he have to escape. And Allah سبحانه وتعالى had mentioned this also in the Quran. While he and the Prophet محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم and Abu Bakr الصديق, both of them in the ghar, in the cave. And he said to him, don't be worried, don't be sad. Indeed, Allah is us. You see? So don't look to yourself to be alone. If you with Allah, if you carry Allah's law, you have everything with you. Even if you're by yourself, because Allah is you. And if Allah is not with you, and you have everybody else with you, you have nothing with you. So what did the Prophet Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم say? Hey, don't worry, understand. Majlis al-Amn, Majlis al-Khawf al-Dawli is going to understand. No. Say, oh, don't worry, Russia understands. They're going to, I gave you understand, they say, and now they're going to say that. Said, لا تحزن. Don't be sad. Don't worry, Abu Bakr. إن الله معنا. This is it. Indeed, Allah with us. If you're doing the work of Allah, don't worry now. You're going to starve sometimes. You're going to be sick sometimes, you are not going to have electricity sometimes, you are not going to have this sometimes, but if Allah with you, وَمَنْ يَتَّقِ اللَّهَ يَجْعَلْ لَهُ مُخْرَجًا وَأَرْزُقُهُ مِنْ حَيْثُ لَا يَحْتَسِبُ. But we have to be strong. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala developed us. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants us to be strong. These weak Muslims, this is not what Islam wants. المؤمن القوي خير وأحب إلى الله من المؤمن الضعيف. Strong believer is more dearer and more beloved by Allah. Why? Khabbab, when Khabbab came to the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, and the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم كان متوسد الكعبة ونائم جنب الكعبة, وقال له يا رسول الله ألا تستنصر لنا؟ It's only one word Khabbab said it. He said, oh Prophet of Allah, why you don't ask Allah to help us? You see what's going to happen, what's happening to us? All these problems, all these hardships that we want. All what it takes you, Prophet, if you say, oh Allah, send victory, this is the end of it. What did the prophet say to him? He said, oh, Khabbab, you understand, you know, I'm going to make dua for you. The prophet was angry at him. The prophet was leaning against the Kaaba, and he said, he was angry, and said, indeed, men before you, لقد كان يؤخذ في من كان قبلكم كان يؤخذ الرجل فيحفر له الحفرة فيوضع في الحفرة ويوضع المنشار في مفرق رأسه ويمشط بأمشاط الحديد فما صدهم ذلك عن الله عن دين الله سوى أسرون جزيون ولكنكم تستعجلون أسرون جزيون people before you they used to make a hold to the believers they stick the believer in it they bring a sword and put it in the middle of his head and cut them to pieces. And they used to curse him with combs made out of iron. They hit it and they combs him between bayna al-lahmi wal-azm. But this never stops him to be believers. You are rushed. You're rushing. I swear by Allah, Allah will complete this mission to such a degree that one of you will travel from Sana'a to Hadramaut or from Mecca to Yemen or from where? He has no fear except Allah wa al-Zayb ala ghadim. But you are wrong. Why is the Prophet did? Because he wanted to develop these people. If everything happened now, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give you ease, you're never going to be a strong believer. You see? But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala developed us. You have this economic sanction, and you have no medical care, and you don't have a clean water to drink, no electricity, and they keep it, make it one year more. These people, they're going to be like mountains. They're going to be strong. They're not going to spoil. They're not going to be babies. They're going to be men, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, من المؤمنين رجال. Allah wants you to be a man, to be tough. That you don't sell your deen for nothing. This is what Allah wanted to develop. Oh brothers, they said they understand if I grow my beard, they're going to fire me. What about if Allah fired you? Oh, never. You see, brother, but you see, actually this is sunnah, and this is not something that Allah, who told you that Allah didn't order you to do it? Akhi, but really you understand. Brother, I have a problem even about my salah. You coming to tell me about my beard? What you mean you have a problem? You don't make salah? Not really. You see, if they know, even if I'm a Muslim, they may fire me. So how do you go about your salah? Astaghfirullah, but really I don't want to talk about it. Astaghfirullah. Why? Say, when I go home at night, understand, I make Zuhra and Asr and Maghrib and Isha together. Subhanallah. Until when you're going to bow down to the kuffar and running by the system of the kuffar and selling your deen from nothing? Ta'isa Abdul Dirham. تعس عبد الخميصة تعس عبد القطيفة تعس وانتكس وإذا شيك فلن تقش same way زرد عبد الله زرد عبد الدولار زرد عبد أمريكا زرد عبد كندا زرد عبد الومن زرد عبد الدنيا زرد عبد البدلة the prophet says this تعس وانتكس misfortune no success for him that be slave and slave yourself for the job brother I never saw you in Juma. Akhi, you know, this is the last year, and after this, I'll get my master's degree, inshallah, I'll be gone. So, how do you know you're going to live until you get your master's degree? And where is this in the Sharia or the deen of the Prophet Muhammad that you can neglect your Juma because you go to school? You have to be a woman, or a slave, or a sick, or a traveler. If you are not one of those people, how you can be neglecting your Juma? For a whole semester, you don't attend Jum'ah, and you tell me, because he sees a success in the master degree, not in the obedience of Allah. This is the weakness of our faith. You see, Rasulullah said, Da'asa wa al-takas. This is the abd of the degree. This is the slave of the school. This is the slave of the company. And never he going to progress. He never going to succeed. Even if you succeed financially, you are not going to be a successful person. We have to take this slavery for the factory and for the degree and the school and the dunya and have our slavery for Allah. Al-ubudiyya lillahi subhanahu wa ta'ala. Say, oh Muhammad, so all these things is not going to work? We're going to do this and do that for you. So the only thing now, the only choice left to kill you. And they tried this with the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Even they tried in Mecca and in Medina. You know, the Yahudi woman. You see, even the kuffar, and I want to let you know, the enemies of Allah, they know some of them, they know about Islam more than some of the Muslims. And this Yahudi woman, that some of the brothers, like the sister was complaining in the sister class, I want to tell you about some of the complaints, that some brothers abuse their women to such a degree, telling her that you've been created from the crooked grave and you are not understanding deficiency in your deen, in your mind as a result of this. You are not supposed to go to the masjid, you are not supposed to go to the majlis of ilm. Neither he bring tapes for her to learn, neither he teaching her in the house. This called wife abuse. Like you call child abuse, this is called wife abuse. But this woman, kuffar women, the Yahudi woman, she knows that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he loves to eat lamb, and the best part he loves is what is that arm. So she took the arm and she put poison in it to poison the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And this was the plots of the enemies. She wanted to kill the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had exposed her plot. So a kuffar woman, she knows about the Prophet. And she said, if he's a true prophet, Allah will save him from it. If he's a liar, he will die. And she knows enough about the Prophet that he loves to eat this part of the animal, so she put the poison there. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has saved him from this. From the blood, again, is the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, since he's the head of this da'wah, they try to make sihr for the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. The Yahud, they make magic. Again, is the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Also, they try and became part of any troops or groups that against the da'wah of Islam. So if they found the Arab fighting against Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, they would go and fight with them. If they found tribe so-and-so is going to attack Medina, they will go and be with them. So all the things, they assisted anybody who fighting against the Muslims. With all these things also, they brought about other notions and other deviations to al-Islam and other bid'ahs, because they found that this Islam is so strong. And those people who carry this da'wah so strong, so they try another ways and means about breaking this philosophy in al-Islam and bringing bid'ah in al-Islam and bringing deviation among the Muslims. All these things is the plots of the Muslims, which nothing new that we see today. But I want to tell you today, due to Nusa Sam, Samus.
It's okay. You can continue.
Come back, Nusa Sam.
Nusa
Sam. So I can try to summarize about pick up some of these things. One of the main things, my brothers, that the kuffar are using today. Pay attention. One of the things that they're using today, they're using the woman. They're using the woman for destruction of Islam. And destruction of mankind in general. Okay? Especially the Yahud. They're using the woman to mean a means to exactly for butchering cheese for the mice, to kill the mice. Okay? They came, how they can get the woman out of the house. They start to tell her about something called liberty, telling her about something called equality, okay? Something called so-called freedom, that you have to be independent, okay? Because by bringing the woman out of the house, they're going to win two things. One, the destruction of the family. The destruction of the family. Because in the absence of a mother in the house, who's going to be taking care of the children? You have two choices, that you're giving it to the kuffar and babysitters, or that you're going to delay it or stop having the children. Okay? So this way, we don't have this scary bomb of Muslims being increasing fast and quick in the number. And this way, we are not going to be obedient to the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, which he encouraged us to have a lot of children. And he said that he'd be proud with our number. So this way, that they can reduce the numbers of the Muslims. Okay? Because the woman is busy. She wants to come outside to work. She wants win her freedom, her liberty. She wants to be free from Allah. She wants to be free from the ubudiyya for Allah, the slavery for Allah. She wants to be free. She wants to be free from the ways that Allah had laid down for her. Now Rasulullah said, "Tanakahu tanasalu, or tanakahu tanasalu." فإني مباهٍ بكم من أمم يوم القيامة أو كما قال صلى الله عليه وسلم that get married and multiply your children because I'll be proud with you in the day of judgment. He wants to see a big nation. But now when he brings a woman outside, who's going to take care of the children? So there is no time to take care of the children. So now let's put a hole in having the children. Or let's have only two or three children, and this is the maximum that we can have, because we have to take care of the house. See? So now put the order of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam aside, and let's now design our own life. Or otherwise, yes, we have some children, and even these two children or three children, who's going to take care of them? Now you're going to have a babysitter, or you're going to take them to the kuffar babysitter, and now you're going to raise them the way they want. And the Prophet Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم is telling us, كل مولود يولد على الفطرة فأبواه يهوداني أو ينصراني أو يمجساني. That every child is born in the upright nature. But his parents, his father and his mother are the one who direct him to be a Christian or a Jew or whatever it is. So in the absence of the father and the mother, who's going to be taking the place of the parents? The babysitters, who is kuffar, or the kindergarten, which is a kuffar, or whatever place where you're going to put them, or you're going to let them watch TV day and night as a babysitter for them. So now, the direction of these children is going to be the direction of what they see in the TV, or what's the direction they see it in the kindergarten school, or the direction that being given by the babysitters. So the mentality and the behavior and the discipline of the babysitter now is going to transfer to your child. Okay? Now bringing the woman outside. Now bringing the woman outside also there is a purpose for it. Now, the woman going to be in the school, she's going to be in the job, she's going to be in the street, she's going to be everywhere. And this is the way how we can put a bait for the fish. How we can get the man busy. How we can see, make a destruction for the Muslim family. Because now we see a woman with black and white and green and yellow and all these beautiful colors, all this temptation. He doesn't see this in his house. He doesn't see this with his wife. Now he's going to admire to see this woman that in his job, the woman that in the school. She looked nice, she looked beautiful, all these things, and now his heart inclining towards her, okay? Now he's seeking a friendship. Now he's seeking whatever it is, okay? And now you will see this will weaken the relationship between a man and his wife. So bringing the woman out of the house is a plot of the enemies of Allah. Now the Muslim woman is not a Muslim woman in this sense of being obedient to her husband, taking care of her children, and وَقَرْنَ فِي بُيُوتِكُنَّ وَلَا تَبَرَّجْنَ تَبَرُّجَ الْجَاهِلِيَّةِ الْأُولَى. And stay in your houses and don't display your beauty like the time of the Jahiliyyah before the Prophet Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم. And nowadays you see more, a lot of Muslim women out of their houses. For what? Because what the husband is doing is not enough. This is the way how the society and a'da'ullah, the enemies of Allah, now tell you that the income of the husband is not enough. Why? Because he put in another means to attack you, حب الدنيا. The love of this material thing, and how you always try to increase from this material thing. So this is going to be in the expenses of your deen. The income of the husband is enough. But we don't know how to praise Allah. We don't know how to be thankful and grateful to Allah because we keep looking to somebody else. What's the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam telling us? What is telling us? انظروا إلى من هو أسفل منكم ولا تنظروا إلى من هو أعلى منكم فإنه أجدر ألا تزدروا نعمة الله أو كما قال صلى الله عليه وسلم. Look to those one who have less than you. Don't look to the one who have more than you. Don't look to those ones who have more than you because this will enable you to appreciate the blessings of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. As long as we keep looking to those who have more than us, we're never going to be grateful. Oh, this sister has more, this brother has more, this family, they have a better furniture, they have a new year car, our car, you understand, is an old model. This is the reason we don't see that the income of the husband is enough. You're not better than the Prophet. You're not better than Aisha. لقد كان يمر الهلال ثم الهلال ثم الهلال ثلاثة أهل في شهرين وما يوقد في البيوت النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم نار. A crescent after a crescent after a crescent. Three moons, three new moons. That means 2 months. And no hot meat been served in the house of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم. He's a prophet of Allah. For 2 months, they didn't kindle fire to cook a hot meal. Say, oh, aunt, how you used to live? He said, Al Aswadain. Tamr wal ma, water and dates. Sometimes some of our neighbors, when they cook, they send us some soup or whatever. But today, you finally understand our houses compared to the houses of the Sahaba like a mansion. They went to Abu Dharr to his house and said, where is your furniture, Abu Dharr? He said, my furniture is there in my other house. In my house. This is not my house. This is only something temporary, like a shelter. My furniture waiting for me. على سور المرفوع. There, where is أكواب الموضوع? Where is نمارك مسقوفة? وزرابيه مكسوسة? Say, my furniture is there. Waiting for me there, not here. And now, the woman doesn't see the income of the husband is enough because she wants this and that and this and that. So now she wants also to go outside to work so she can bring more money. And now, how many of our wives or our daughters that they go to school, they have a hijab, Islamic hijab. I'm not talking about so-called, what we call it hijab, scarf, jean, and little bit long shirt, and we call it hijab. Subhanallah. You know when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَلَا تَبَرَّجُوا تَبَرُّجَ الْجَاهِلِيَّةِ الْأُولَى. Don't display your beauty like the time of jahiliyyah. What did the woman in jahiliyyah used to do? She used to have a khimar. The only thing she used to expose her neck. She used to throw the hijab, the khimar, behind her shoulder. So now you can see her neck and expose it in the front of her body. This is Jahiliyyah. Some of our women today, the worst than the time of Jahiliyyah. Wallahi, wallahi, they are worse than the time of Jahiliyyah in the way how they dress. And now when you go to try to give them advice, now they become a mufti. Say, brother, is not how many people make salah and cover and they are not sincere in their heart? Allah doesn't care for the way how we look. It's not the way how you look, it's the main thing in your heart is good. You see? Now even they go instead say, make dua for us, I know I'm guilty, I'm wrong. No, now they're going to give you fatwa, they're going to argue with you and they stick their finger in your eyes and tell you you're wrong. I am okay. I am the mother of the believer, I'm Aisha. This is what they want to do. But this, because the enemies of Allah, they plotted and they used the woman. And this became a good way for them to mislead a lot of Muslims and keep them away from their deen. And as I say, the destruction happened in the children, the destruction happened with our relationship with Allah, and the destruction happened in the marriage itself. Because now we have a problem, a man seeing a woman mixed with him in his shop, in his school, she looks so beautiful. Now he's not thinking too much about his wife. And now their children, they have no love from their mother because their mother is so busy going outside to get the dog. So, and Allah is not pleased with us. Now who's pleased? The enemies of Allah. So they're using the woman. And this became a good means for them to captive Allah, to detach a lot of Muslims and to make them go away from what is supposed for them to be done. One of the means of the enemies of Allah to fight us and beguile us from our deen, they already try the best to have control, an absolute control over the media. Name it. Radio, TV, newspaper. They have the upper hand. Okay? And through the media, they feed in everybody. Okay? And usually, people, they listen to the louder voice. If you talk soft and somebody else is shouting, you will hear the person be shouting more than the person, okay? So the media have a lot of impact. And some people, because the weakness of our faith, we listen to these things, okay? And now they attack the people, not in the streets, they attack the people even in their own houses. And if you are not busy with the remembrance of Allah, you're going to be busy with the tricks of the shaitan. And now they give it all kinds of flavors. They put all the flavors. What they like, politics, they will keep you busy with politics. What they love, sports, you will can find all kinds of sports. What they love, movies, kind of movies there. So whatever, even for the children, they make cartoons for them, they make everything to fit. Children, men, women. They give everybody, they have a meal for everybody to feed and keep them busy. And especially living in America and Canada, we are more danger. Because some places in Arabia, in Islamic country or so-called Islamic country, whatever, at least sometime, like 1 o'clock, 12 o'clock, whatever it is at night, the TV station say, Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah, you have a good night. And they finish all this haram that they will say with some verses from the Quran. Okay? Now after the idha' is finished, and all the tamthiliyya and the movie is finished, now we نأتي الآن, now we want to come to finish our program, and now we listen to some verses of the Quran, and they put the Quran for you for 5 minutes, and TV is closed by one. But living in a country like this is so serious, because some, if not most, if not all, the TV station for 24/7, non-stop. Is it correct? Some like this, is it? All of them? How much? What do you hear with this?
200
channels. 200? 200. The brother says the last report there, 200 channels. Who can give more? 200
channel. So what? If you want whatever that you want, you will find it there. And this is something what you take your eyes, takes your ear, and makes you understand, and now with the remote control and all the things, now you don't have even to go to spend some time and drive in front of a taxi to go to the movie, we'll bring it to you all the way to your house. Okay, we're going to get you the poison, we're going to kill you inside your own house. And we make you pay for the poison. We're going to make you pay for the poison. They're going to kill you and kill your children. And after this, what is Islam? So they attack the Muslims and the human being in general through the media by giving false information. This is one thing, okay? And the second thing, giving you things which relate to your taste or what you desire. And the shaitan also there to work in you, to be tempted by these things and taking you away from the salah, the remembrance of Allah. Said some brother, but listen, actually we go make salah, alhamdulillah. I go twice to the masjid to make my salah. This because they think it's not only about your salah. We have a lot of things to do. And don't think because you come to the masjid twice a day that you fulfill your obligation. Especially living in a place like America and Canada. Look to our children. Look to the future of our children. What's going to happen to them? And again comes again one thing. If it's not designed especially for our children, but we the Muslims have to understand that the kuffar is our enemies. What's happening? The public schools. What's a public school about? Somebody says this is nothing but education. Alright, I may agree with you, it's education. But who is the one who put in this education in your child mind? Okay? Who is the one that spending time with your child 5 days a week for 6 and 7 hours a day? Believe it or not, my brothers and my sisters, some of us, our children who go to the public school, they spend time with the kuffar more than they spend with the Muslims in general, including their father and their mothers. So if there is a child spending time with the kuffar more than he's spending with the Muslim community, including the father and the mother, what do you be expecting? Where our future generation going to? What kind of direction? Where is the alternative that been created by leaders and organizations and sheikhs and scholars and da'iyah to save the Muslims and generation from going to kufr? What about what they teach in the school? What about safe sex? Did you hear about it? What about mingling? What about distributing free condom? What about music? What about mixing, especially in so-called gym, physical education, or what you call it? They call it physical education or something like this? Huh? Where are we going? Where is our future? Where is our children going? How you can trust your enemy that you take the most beloved thing to you, the most dear thing to you, which is a child, and you drive him every day and grab him to the kuffar? 8 o'clock, you're taking your child, giving it to the kuffar for 7 hours a day. How we can do this? Oh, brother, we don't have time to teach our children. We don't have time, you understand it? So what do you have time for? حب الدنيا. The love of this dunya. Working too hard for this dunya. Working too hard for this dunya, even in the cost and the expenses of our own families. Go ahead here, now.
Now there are homosexuals and lesbians teaching our children in the school openly.
Okay. We're not going to come to this now, or otherwise we're going to be opening a big subject before us. Getting the people busy with this dunya by creating and inventing every day new technology, a modern way to use this, and more fancy way to use this, And now you won't spend more time to have the money to buy the things, okay? As a result of this, the more that you working, the more time is taking you away from your deen and from your obligation towards the mosque and towards your family. In actuality, in our countries, there is different tactics, different than here, and I was trying to get you the things which are related to our condition. But as example, one of the things that they did in different countries, they call it muharabat al-iqta'. Iqta' in their terminology, that these people who are rich and they own hundreds of acres of land, millions of dollars and things like this. Now they try to say that we're going to have a revolution against this. We're going to have something called equality and distribution of wealth among the people. See the tricks? Pay attention. The poor person, he will have a big smile and get happy when he hear about this. Because most of these leaders, okay, that they are in position, they are nothing except a puppet for this kuffar, okay? They help them and they get them in this position. So now it comes, say the leader is going to have a war against the iqta'. We're going to distribute wealth in a fair way to everybody. So the person who have 300 of acres of land, we're going to snatch it away from him, and we're going to give him what is sufficient for him and his family. We give him 100, and we take this 200. And we're going to give this 200 5 feet and 5 feet and 2 here and 3 here. SubhanAllah. Now, a common Muslim, a poor Muslim, a person who's not well educated about this, he will be happy for this. And now, this will give him to love this leader and love this government and love this constitution of this country. But do you know that this is haram? How you can go snatch a property of somebody? Do you know that Allah intended for these people, some to be rich and some people to be poor? وَاللَّهُ فَضَّلَ بَعْضَهُمْ عَلَى بَعْضٍ فِي الرِّزْقِ. That Allah intended to make some of you higher than others in provision. It happened. It happened even amongst the Sahaba. The Prophet ﷺ did not say, you bring all what you got, I give you 10, and we distribute the 5 to others. It's called shuri'i. Common. Everything to be owned by everybody. It's going to be owned by the government, or that we take from the rich and cut it, and we give a little bit here and there. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala established zakat. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has established charity. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has told us about a lot of blessings when a person do this and do that. You don't need somebody to come and take the property of some people, and after this we're going to have equality. What are you going to do, equality? What about a person who has 5 kids, and somebody have no kids? Can you go and say, we're going to make a fair distribution, we're going to take 2 of your children and give this man who doesn't have any children? How you can do this? See? Now they come to fool you again with something else and tell you that we're going to have democracy. See? We're going to have a democracy. What does this mean, democracy? What? There is nothing called democracy in Islam. And now, حكم الشعب بالشعب, دستور. That ruling people by the people. You're going to be the one who say what can be done, what could not be done. You are the leaders of your own self. We take representative out of you, and this representative, they come, and we make a law how to live. What is the punishment? What is the reward? What is the penalty? What is what? All the things. And some people, they will laugh and smile and get happy and think they're getting something. They're stealing Islam from you. They steal Islam from you. What about the shura in Islam? What about consultation in Islam? We don't need democracy. There is nothing called democracy. Because democracy means snatching the rulership from Allah and give it to mankind. And Allah said, Malik al-Nas, Ilah al-Nas. He is the king of mankind, and he is the Ilah and the deity of mankind, and he is the Musharri' of mankind. And he said, إِنَ الْحُكْمُ إِلَّا لِلَّهِ أَمَرَ أَلَّا تَعْبُدُوا إِلَّا إِيَّهِ. How you can replace Allah and put a man or men to legislate for a people? They plotted against you. They taken your deen from you in a way like exactly like somebody putting the poison in the man. And they think that you're getting something out of the enemies of Allah. The enemies of Allah, they don't have to be wearing a cross down their neck. They can be the same skin color and talk in the same language. مِنْ جُلْدَتِنَا وَيَتَكَلَّمُونَ بِأَلْسِنَتِنَا. Okay? They don't have to wear the cross. But these people have been raised up and been nourished and been prepared by those people who wear the cross. They've been raised and nourished and prepared by the people who wear the cross. So sometimes you get it directly or you get it indirectly. Because if we come in your country, you're going to fight us. So we got to let somebody from your own country talk in the same language, he will present it to you. Now we're going to be about democracy, and now we're going to have the constitution, and we're going to have, you understand, these offices and that and that. How you can change the book of Allah, how you can remove the Islam from our life. Nobody told you to stop to be a Muslim. The mosque is open. Go and make salah. Who stopped you? Go make salah. Who told you that Islam is only salah? قُلْ إِنَّ صَلَاتِ وَنُسُكِ وَمَحْيَايَ وَمَمَاتِ لِلَّهِ رَبِّ الْعَالَمِينَ. Everything have to be Islam. Everything have to be according to Islam. Your social life, your economic life, your political life, everything have to be according to Islam. In actuality, my brothers and my sisters, the blood of the enemies of Allah is a lot. And we have to be careful. We have to be awake. And we have to be always prepared. And we have to understand that it's our responsibility. As Allah said, Ya ayyuha alladhina amanu, qu anfusakum wa ahlikum nar. Oh, you believe, save yourself as well as your children from hell fire. We are, as the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, kullukum ra'in wa kullukum mas'ulun an ra'iyati. Kullukum ra'in وَكُلُّكُمْ مَسْئُولٌ عَنْ رَعِيَّتِهِ. Each one of you is a governor, and each one of you is responsible about his government. So the enemies of Allah, they plotting against you day and night. And the shaitan is against you, and yourself against you, and the dunya is against you. So we have to say, إِيَّاكَ نَعْبُدُ وَإِيَّاكَ نَسْتَعِينُ. Thee we worship, and in thee Allah we ask in help. Put your trust in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Learn your deen. And accept the deen that came with the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, revealed by the angel Jibreel. Not that Islam that won't be presented nowadays. American Muslim. This is the melting pot for all the cultures. No. We are not part of, we are not going to be melt. المؤمن القوي خير وأحب إلى الله من المؤمن الضعيف. And it will come the time that will be a person holding to his deen like a person who holds to a piece of fire. The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم had told us بدأ الدين غريبا وسيعود غريبا كما بدأ. Deen had started as a stranger and will return back again to the same stage. Okay? We have a big shop. And we have to understand that we need to keep our eyes open, because Allah had told us, وَلَا يَزَالُونَ يُقَاتِلُونَكُمْ حَتَّى يَرُدُّوكُمْ عَنْ دِينِكُمْ إِنِ اسْتَطَاعُوا. They continue fighting you to turn you away from your religion if they can do so. This is the only thing scaring them from you, and if they take their deen from you, they will be happy with you. If you drop your deen and you live as American, live as Canadian, live as a Frenchman, live and whatever it is with no deen, you are their friend and they will love you and they will kiss you on your cheek and give you some dollars in your hand. Other than this, you saying Sunnah, you saying Quran, you saying this and that, you be the one that always in front of them to attack you, regardless if you are an individual or family or a community or a society. And I leave, inshallah, the rest of the time, which I think is supposed to be 10 minutes to 15 minutes for questions and answers or comments. Let me make something. Is this something somebody sent it in Arabic here? And I really, it's a disturbance, but let me say, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, Sheikh Muhammad Sayyid Adli Hafidahullah. نحن نبحث عن الحقيقة. ما هذه الفتنة التي تسببتم فيها؟ والشيوخ قالوا لا نسمع لكم. أفيدونا يرحمكم الله ما هي الحقيقة وجزاكم الله خيرا. Say in the name of Allah, the most compassionate, the most merciful. Dear Sheikh, no, excuse me, no dear. Sheikh Muhammad Sayyid Adli, may Allah protect him. We are searching concerning the truth. What is this fitna and trial, which you was the cause of it? That mean me. The sheikhs said, I don't know who this sheikh that you're referring to, they said not to listen to you. Please help us. May Allah be mercy with you. And what is the truth? May Allah reward you. I assume that this brother, because I met a brother today, he's telling me about something, about some of the sheikhs, that they said even not to spread my tapes. I wish that the brother had mentioned some of these sheikhs. So number one, we know that who they are. And number two, if they are sheikhs or no. This is something very important. I didn't been in a cause of any fitna. If anybody knows that I was cause of a fitna, let him come before the Muslims and say it. The only thing that I did, what we've been always taught, to respect and consult our sheikhs. Sheikhs. And some of you know that I've been here for the last 25 years, alhamdulillah, giving the da'wah, and all my tapes is witness that is nothing but Quran and Sunnah. And by Allah's means, that I don't report any weak hadith, and if I do, it will be a mistake, and somebody correct me, I will say I was mistaken. I have hundreds, if it's not thousand, at least tapes. All what you need, bring one single audio tape or a video tape and show me that I said something is not Quran and Sunnah. I don't want to get in details in the subject because it is a fitna. The only reason that I don't want to get into this subject because I had sent a message with Brother Dawood Adib, and I sent the same message with Abu Usama al-Dhahabi to give it to Sheikh Ali al-Halabi in the conference of Quran and Sunnah, which is supposed to be Detroit, to let him know to come to see me in Columbia, South Carolina, before I start to speak, not to be a real fitna. Because if I start to speak, I will expose some individuals, and I will expose some organizations, or a organization. So I don't want to talk. I want to be patient, And if Brother Ali Halabi come, I will sit down and tell him this for a simple reason, that my understanding that the brother in the Quran and Sunnah, who's in charge, Jam'iyat al-Quran and Sunnah, he have a lot of high regard and respect for Sheikh Ali Halabi. So I'm going to talk to his Sheikh first. And if the people do not stop their fitna, I will expose certain individuals and other things that is not good to be said. But Allah said, لا يحب الله جهر بالسوء من القول إلا من ظلم. Allah doesn't like to hear speaking loudly and openly about evil, except the one who will transgress against. I believe that people have transgressed against me, and I have witnesses, but I'm trying to keep my mouth shut until I will see some firmness. Okay? But if Brother Ali Al-Halabi didn't come to talk to me, there is a big possibility that I will put 6 audio tapes for all the Muslims in America and Canada to know about what is going on. The only mistake, they call it a mistake and fitna, that I will try to unite some of the leaders and the da'iyah, like Abu Muslima, Dawood Adil, Usama Zahabi, Ali Tamimi, Jamal Zabuza. It's an invitation to all these people. I don't do anything under the table. I'm an open person. Anybody know about me playing games for the last 25 years? I want somebody to stand up and tell me. And I send invitation to all these people that we need to come together and form some kind of a unity of leaders among ourselves to have a head so we can have organized efforts. This is all what I did. Sheikh Ibn Uthaymeen, Hafidahullah, had bought a book called Al-Aqliyat al-Muslimah. And one of his fatwa in this book, which is a book also translated in English called Muslims Minority in the West, something in this meaning. And one of the questions, he said that the Muslims in the West, they need to get together and unite their effort and they have a head over them. And this head, they can call him Imam, Sheikh, leader, Imam, Amir, whatever names they can agree about it, let them have it. So if Sheikh Ibn Uthaymeen is not a scholar, who is a scholar today? If Sheikh Ibn Uthaymeen is not a scholar, who is a scholar today? And I act according to the fatwa of Sheikh Ibn Uthaymeen. And it is published. And is there a brother here by name Saeed? I'm sorry to put somebody in the spot. Is Saeed here? I saw the brother today in Asr. His brother from Somali, and he's the imam of the Masjid Zair, Islamic Center of Maryland in United States. Huh? He left? Okay. You can ask Saeed. I'll ask Saeed, brother Saeed, and another brother called Abdurrahman Afridi, in Hajj, because somebody representative of Quran and Sunnah Society, he came in our meeting and said, you misunderstood the fatwa of Sheikh Ibn Uthaymeen. I asked the brothers, please kindly, if I'm wrong, I want to be corrected. And I want everybody to know. No problem. Go to the Sheikh and ask him. And the brothers, they went with the tape recorder, and they sat there with the Sheikh in the last Hajj, and they asked him, we are our situation such and such and such in America. And somebody came and invited us, and such number of imams and da'iyah came together. And now they elected one person, okay? And they called him Amir. Is there something wrong in it? The Sheikh told them this is not wrong and what you're doing right and you have to do this. And Saeed is witness and this is tape. A month ago or 2 months ago, all right, the Sheikh Ibn Uthaymeen Hafidhahullah, he had given lecture over the phone in Florida. And they repeated the same question again to him. Is it haram? Is it sunnah? Is it makruh? What do you stand about this Amir business? And the Sheikh repeated his fatwa again. Now, before this, three of those brothers, if you want to call them sheikhs, or you call them students of knowledge, whatever you want to call them, it depends what you see them. I see them to be nothing except students of knowledge, comparing to Sheikh Ibn Uthaymeen. And this, Salim al-Hilali. All right? Muhammad Musa Nasr and Usama al-Qusi. And three of them debated this issue with me. I'm not going to get in details in the issue. And they told me that I misunderstand the fatwa of the Sheikh. I said, okay, no problem. After debates of 3 hours, I said, no problem. And I left this alone. Now, if the people are not going to give me my right and my respect as a student of knowledge or as a sheikh or as a da'iyah, I will start to speak about details of Quran and Sunnah and what they're doing and the Hizbiyyah and the Asian, being an Asian, I'll be putting all the business in the street for everybody. But I didn't create a fitna. If unity among the Muslims is going to be fitna, if organizing the imams and the da'iyah is fitna, so why are you calling me and causing the fitna? And even after these people said that what I'm doing is wrong, I say, okay, it's wrong, I drop it. So why I still cause a fitna? Why I'm calling a fitna? What do you, I came here 2 years ago. I used to be invited for Quran and Sunnah. You know that I came here, you understand what's Quran and Sunnah before, and you, some of you saw me in the conference of Quran and Sunnah. Why now I'm a bad boy? What do I teach here different from what I teach there? Is this not a hisbiyah? Brothers, let me tell you one thing, because if you, I don't want to really talk, and I wish the brother did not brought this issue, but I want to tell you one thing. Out of fairness, I was a president in a meeting between representative of the Ayana and representative of Quran and Sunnah. And after a long discussion, the brothers who are in charge, or the second person in the Ayana, said we are delegation from the Ayana and we are here, whatever we give you and tell you, the Ayana will go by it. We are willing to merge our conference. We are even willing to be under you. And we have only one organization. Allah is my witness, sitting in his house, that the Quran and Sunnah Society refused the Ayana to be under them. And they call them names, and they give them labels, and make excuses why they could not work with them. I don't, when I talk, I will let you know what is the fitna is. But I'm waiting. The next week, if I don't talk with Ali al-Halabi, if he doesn't come and talk with me, now I'm going to put everything for everybody. And for you, you get to know who's the one creating the fitna, and who's the one who caused a division, and who's the one about Hispania, and who's the one you understand is the Asian, and who's the one, I'm going to put all the cards in the table. Okay? So if you think because I brought Abu Muslimah, Abu Usama, and invited all these people to get together as one ummah, to unite our effort, if you call it this fitna, so that this unity is not the fitna, so I'm guilty now. But if you think what I did was something good, and the ulama supported this, so now you judge it for yourself. I'm sorry for this, brothers. Excuse my emotion, but I'm so disturbed with it myself. And I want to tell you one thing. You buy my tapes or you don't buy my tapes. Hey, You are not putting food in my table. With all respect. I'm not living out of these pennies and nickels that I'm making out of the tapes. These tapes is for to help the Muslims to know their deen, the pure deen. You want to buy it? Alhamdulillah, don't. Some of these tapes you get it for the cost price, and some people they get financial assistance. That means they send a letter say, I don't have money, but I want to have tapes. We send them the tapes. So if you don't want to buy my tapes, it's fine. So what? All right? I'm a free da'iyah. If the Quran and Sunnah invite me to talk, I will talk. If the Ayana invite me to talk, I will talk. If the Kuffar ask me to come in Senegal and a church to come at Islam, I will go any place, and my mission and my message is not going to change. It's going to be, Allah said, His Messenger said, the Sahaba understood. If you're not happy with me, hey, is a, like they say, it's a free country. All right? It's a free country. I'm a free man. I came in this country to teach, not to kiss somebody's hand. And I'm not going to kiss anybody's hand. I'm telling you. You deal with a tough person, you will get to know how tough as soon as you hear from them. And Allah is best. Please forgive me. It's time for the bus to show up. Go ahead, brother. Did anybody send me a question? I'm sorry, brothers. Please forgive me. It's too late for questions and answers. Okay. Or it's too late for the fitna. Actually, they put it in the internet, they put it everywhere. I don't, let's assume that the whole Prophet said you are not supposed to call yourself Amir. So I did a nasiha. These sheikhs or students of knowledge are supposed to come say, brother, what you're doing is good, but this thing about you be the Amir who don't want to use this term. Did a nasiha. But you come to destroy everything? Where is it in Islam? Where is the hikmah? Where is the wisdom? So brother, I didn't get the internet yet, I didn't talk yet, and the way I talk will be something else, inshallah. Please make this tape available to anybody. Let it go to Ali Harabi, Salim Hilali, go to Ibn Mas'ud, go to Ibn Husaymin, go to anybody. I'm a free man, I'm not scared from anybody, I'm not lying, take it and let them hear it. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. شيخ محمد جزاكم الله خيرا. هل الأسماء الجماعات الإسلامية في هذا العصر من العقبات في طريقنا أم لا؟ Indeed, the brother asking, is the names, titles of these groups and organizations are part of the obstacles in our way or no? Indeed, it is. Indeed, it is. We supposed to be, as the Prophet said, like one body. When one member suffer, all the body suffer. And I want to tell you about one game, okay? And I hope that the recording is still working, because I'm not scared from anybody, Afro-American or white American, Arab or non-Arab. There is a big game going with some Muslims called Salafi, all right? If you want to be Salafi, live Salafi, talk Salafi, act Salafi. It became like a game. This it. Okay? And I'm telling you from my personal experience. Those people who think they are Salafi, we want to see the Salafiya in their behavior, in their action. Okay? So somebody calling himself this name, but he's not living the name. So you try to tell me that if I don't say I'm Salafi, now I'm not Salafi? And because you call yourself a Salafi, now you are Salafi? أَمْ لَكُمْ كِتَابٌ فِيهِ تَدْرُسُونَ إِنَّ لَكُمْ فِيهِ لَمَا تَخَيَّرُونَ Do you have a book which you study? Indeed, in this book you don't have what you're judging by. What's going on? Right? And now you think Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the day of judgment. He's going to ask you, oh, your name is George, you go to hellfire, and your name is Ibrahim, go to paradise? Action. What do you believe? What's the principles that you're up to? Okay? So names doesn't mean anything. You can call yourself Ayana or Tajammu Islami or Quran and Sunnah or Salafi, or you call yourself whatever you want to call, if your action and if your belief and what you live up and your akhlaq is not up to what you put, this is nothing. This indeed nothing means nothing. ملة أبيكم إبراهيم هو سماكم المسلمين. What did your prophet, your father Ibrahim call you? Muslims. We are Muslims, we are believers. And sometimes we create these names only to show you superiority over each other that I'm better than you. What this means is that in Salafi, I'm not living Salafi. Hello, this is my witness here. This is my witness in the dunya, and this is my witness in the hereafter. And this is my witness against Quran and Sunnah and Ayat. And I know he's going to help me now. This is a brother, his name is Saeed, and you should catch him and ask him, did he go for Hajj? And I ask him to do this. To ask Sheikh Ibn Uthaymeen about it or no. I know he's going to help me, he never wants to see me again. But hey, if you love me for Allah, alhamdulillah, you want to help me, hit me for Allah or don't hit me. This is a man. He has a tape recorder, he held on his own ears, last the Hajj, he sat with Sheikh Ibn Uthaymeen. This is not this. May Allah forgive us and forgive him and forgive all of us. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bring our hearts together. Make Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala good Muslims following the sunnah of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Please, brothers, buy me tapes. Please. Please, brothers. I call the brother. But anyway, no. Please ask me to stop talking about this. Please, I beg of you already. I'm a human being, I have my weakness. And because I know that I've been mazloom, that people transgress against me, and I'm going to talk, and I'm, please stop me to talk about it. Yes, sir. Between shaitan and soul? Yes, two different things, Akhi. Your soul is you, is yourself, okay? The shaitan, which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created him from fire. The shaitan is kafir, okay? You've been given the two ways, as Allah said, وَهَدَيْنَاهُ نَجْدَيْنِ. That your soul can adopt any of these two ways, or three ways. Your nafs can be nafs lawwam, that when you do something will admonish you. The inward inside you, okay? When Rasulullah ﷺ said to this Sahabi, I think Sahl ibn Sa'd, he said, جئت تسأل عن البر، البر حسن الخلق والإثم ما حاك في صدرك وكرهت أن يطلع عليه الناس. He said, you came to ask about righteousness. Righteousness is good deed, or good manner, good behavior, good discipline. Okay? And if sin is what disturbs you from inside, and you hate the people to see. So your nafs is the inward of you, which you understand that when you do something wrong, that you... Why you look right and left? Because you want to make sure that nobody see you, and as soon as nobody see you, now you put it in your pocket. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made you, this conscience inside you, to be like a fire alarm. When there is a fire and smoke, start beep, 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 beep. The same thing the Muslims have his nafs inside, his conscience. This is the best way I can describe it. Your inward or your conscience that will disturb you when you're doing the haram and the evil. Okay? So there is two different things between shaitan and between the nafs of the human being or your soul or whatever it is. Brother Zain, please forgive me. I will kiss your forehead for this. But I'm sorry, Allah meant for you to come, but please forgive me for the sake of Allah. Somebody actually asked me about the fitna. He said, I created a fitna. So, and I use you as a witness. And if I lie against you, please let the people that I lie against you. If not, remain silent. I told them that I sinned. I asked you for Hajj to go to meet Sheikh Ibn Uthaymeen and ask him that what we did is correct or bid'ah, so we can correct. And my understanding is that he came with the answer that yes, is correct. And doesn't matter, you call him Imam, you call him Amir, you call him whatever it is, that is acceptable, yes, he can do it. Oh, the brother shook his hand and he said what? He said yes? You mean you went to Hajj? You met Sheikh Ibn Uthaymeen? You told him about our fitna, and he said it's okay to elect somebody over you. And he can call him Amir. Is Sheikh Ibn Uthaymeen is a scholar to your knowledge? Allahu Akbar. The brother say he doesn't know anybody more scholar than him. This is a man, I catch him. He's my witness. I didn't do anything without the instruction of the scholars. So if the students of knowledge are not happy, this is a problem. Yes, please, help me, Akhi. Financial difficulty, and they know this, they realize the husband and the wife, and the wife wants to go work, and the husband doesn't want to have to do, okay? Is this almost the question? Yeah? Aren't you working in the night time, night shift? This is worse than even work. Actually, I advise the sister, the husband, he say he doesn't agree with your work. I will advise my Muslim sister to fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and obey her husband and be patient with this deficiency in the financial condition. Even they eat nothing but rice and tomato sauce. Even if they eat nothing but peanut butter and jam, be patient, don't go mix, don't be working with the kafirun. Don't displease your husband, don't displease Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Be patient, and وَمَنْ يَتَّقِ اللَّهَ يَجْعَلْ لَهُ مَخْرَجًا وَيَرْزُقْهُ مِنْ حَيْثُ لَا يَحْتَسِبُ. That whosoever fear Allah, have the taqwa of Allah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will provide for them from means they have no expectation. We have to have sabr. We just said about Aisha and the Prophet. For brothers, please, the worst, the poorest one among us, who among us that he can tell me stay for 2 months without having a happy? Come on, guys, let's be serious. Let's be serious. A woman going outside the house, living in a bin with a kuffar for 6 hours, working night shift, she may have, you understand, to do something about her hijab and be mixing. All these things because what? Because the bread? Because they don't want to eat peanut butter and jelly? Fear Allah, be patient, be patient, be patient. Allah will make a means, inshallah. Allah will make a way. And also, in the meantime, that husband and wife, they need to sit down together and go over their expenses. Maybe they can cut something that is not necessary. Maybe they have 3 bedrooms, maybe they can have 2 bedrooms. Maybe, understand, they're using too much electricity, unnecessary. You see, there is means and ways also that we can try to do things. And other alternative, maybe she can do some work inside the house, like sewing, babysitters, things like this, without disturbing her husband and breaking the rules of the Islam. Abu Ahmed Zahir can sit me with Sami'a and see the brothers in want to make their salah. I don't want to burden you with my speech, okay? My name is, do you want me to say the name? Okay, my name is Yusuf. I have been working in IB. Should I say also when? Okay, and I've been working in a bank for about 10 years. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgive you, brother, and may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give you tawbah, inshallah, very soon. Some people say working in the bank is haram. No, it's not haram. It is worse than the term haram. It's haram, haram, haram. I never got a clear definition on this. Could you please make some understanding about this? Simple explanation due to the time. Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam curses 3 people. The R3 are what? The one who gave it, the one who take it, and the one who's witness to it. What's this? Those who deal with the usury. Those who deal with the interest. The one who give it. لعن الله أكل الربا. لعن. لعن. Allah curse. How a person can be successful and cursed by Allah. How a person can be successful in his life and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala initiate the war against him. لعن الله أكل الربا. وموكلون وشاهدين. So that means anybody assist in a usury institution is part of it. Even if you are kannas, the bank, if you are even mopping the floor in the bank, you are part of this institution of usury. Giving it? Oh brother, I don't need it, I only give it. Oh, you involved. Oh no, no, I have nothing to do with this. All what I do, they need a notary. And now I put my signature. You are involved. Serious. You work as a guard for the bank, you are cursed. You go fix the computer of the bank, you are cursed. وَتَعَوَنُ عَلَى الْبِرِّ وَالتَّقْوَى وَلَا تَعَوَنُ عَلَى الْإِثْمِ وَالْعُدْوَانِ. Help one another with righteousness and good deeds. And don't help one another with sin. Transgression. Do you think this short answer is sufficient for you, my brother? This matter, due to the fact is it serious, I want to hear from you. You can debate the issue with me, no problem. I allow you to do this. If this answer is not enough for you, my brother, tell me why. It's clear, alhamdulillah, this is by fadlullah. This is by the mercy of Allah, and we pray that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala get you out of this trouble as soon as possible. And the least sin, the least, the smallest sin of dealing with usury, like one committed adultery with his own mother. Huh? It's not my words, it's the Prophet said. How you can imagine? A dirham, one single dirham from usury, you eat it knowingly, worse than committing zina 36 times. 36 times. Like committing adultery. 36 times for each dirham you get from. We need to get back to Allah. We could not be in a war. How you can stand in front of a whole America fighting by yourself? No, you are not against America only. You are against Allah. It's so scary. Brother, if you put your job tonight and you have nothing to eat until you die, it's much better for you. But inshallah, you put your trust in Allah and do it, and Allah never going to neglect you. Of a widow? Okay. The brother asking about working for a woman that out of necessity, like a widow. If we have a widow among ourselves, it is our responsibility. We as a Muslim community. Okay? Not only send the money for Bosnia and Kashmir and here and there. What about Muslim? We have to know what's going on in our community. It is a responsibility. And also this widow can get married, is it? And also maybe this widow having children to support the heir. Okay? So all these things have to be taken consideration. But let's assume nothing is working. Nothing, nothing, nothing. We said to her, yes, it can work, but there is no relationship between taking your hijab off and working. You can work, and they try to have a halal work, and try to find a work that mostly women in it, and all these things, okay? Until Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make another way for you, inshallah. No, actually, she should work until she found a different means. And as I said, different means for the community to assist her, or for her to get married, or one of her kids to work and support her. So she takes this work as a temporary, okay? This is not the place for the woman to be outside, okay? So she will take it out of a necessity, and as soon as the necessity is removed, she has to get back to be with her family, and especially with the woman, you understand, we need to take care of them, not let them expose outside to the servant.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, living in this country and this country dealing with you three and all this institution. Does it come to take you off your own house, grab you by your shirt and tell you have to work in the bank? No. Oh, this is his problem, you understand? You are not, you understand in part in it directly, otherwise you understand that I'm not responsible about what they're doing, but I'm not going to support this, okay? I'm not going to support it. And one of them is not supported, regardless if it's the country or the general public, that I don't put my money in the bank. And somebody said, where I can put it? There is a safe deposit box. And let's assume there is a need for having money in the bank. Your expenses during the month, say $5,000. Why you have $50,000 in the bank? Answer me. Your money is generating interest. Brother, but I don't take the interest. But do you know they take your money and lend it to somebody else? So you have the kuffar, giving them willingly your money and put it in the bank. Take this money and put it in a safe deposit box. How do you bank them? Bank with Allah. A sister sent a question, say, brother, how do you bank them? Bank with Allah. مَنْ ذَلَّذِي يُقْرِضُ اللَّهُ أَلَّهَ قَرْضًا حَسَنًا فَيُضَاعِفُ لَهُ. Let your deals with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, give Allah a beautiful loan, spend your money fi sabilillah, this is the way how you're going to be banking. Okay. Alhamdulillah, very good question. Now, I'm saying the safe deposit box will be as another alternative if you are not want to keep the money in your house someplace. And this you pay $20, $50 a year, whatever it is, this for renting this box. And buying, you see, paying $20 is less than giving them $50,000 sitting there, they're using it day and night. So when we are faced by two evil, we take the least, okay? Yes.
So if we give our income tax money to the government, we're doing these programs, safe sex education, and they're doing this part, they're using our income tax money to do a lot of things.
Okay.
A guest was coming to a grant where he received $65 million for our income tax money. So I mean, because then the human debt is going on, you know, on. So where does it?
Where you draw the limit, huh? Where you must stop, yes, okay. Now, number one, are you forced to be in this country?
I was a foreigner.
Okay.
And where would you live?
No, let's talk in general.
Yeah, I want to talk in general.
Okay.
Let's say...
I heard it from you, do you mind to hear from me? Because I know you understand he is, like he said, he's going to be connected, but we're talking. Actually, if we came here to this country with our own choice, okay? I'm not saying about people may be born here or people that they have persecution in the country and they have to come here. If we come here for our own choice, they say if you could not take the heat, get out of the country. Okay? You came to Canada or to America with your only choice, left is a place that have a van 5 times a day, a place that you can be from away from this haram and you choose to come here. So why you don't go back home? Oh, but because we don't like, understand, this dirty water, you understand, we don't want this kind of electricity, we want to have a fancy life. So have a fancy life in the expenses of your deed, this is your problem. Now, I'm paying tax, are you giving it with your only choice? Do you have a way to get away from paying the tax? So you did not give the tax with your own choice, and you're giving it while you hate it. And if you can stop it, you will stop it. So actually, we could not keep connected until like this, okay? We have to draw the limit. I'm talking about things that you do it willingly.